Good afternoon. Thank you for coming. Can everyone hear me? I'm Michael Lind, Policy Director of the Economic Growth Program at the New America Foundation. And it's my great pleasure to welcome you to this event featuring Ha-Joon Chang, author of Economics, the User's Guide. Professor Chang is a professor at the University of Cambridge and a frequent consultant with organizations such as the United Nations and other international agencies. He's become very prominent in recent years as a spokesman for what is sometimes called heterodox economics, which I would define as, to use another term, real-world economics. I am not a PhD economist. Most of what I learned from economics, sadly, was from sources other than the current neoclassical economics profession. I discovered as an undergraduate in college and in graduate school that if you wanted to learn about business organization or the structure of public utilities or government regulation or social insurance or waves of innovation and technology from the steam engine to the internal combustion engine, the last place you would actually go to learn about these fundamental aspects of the economy would be an economics department. And I thought that was kind of strange. You know, it was sort of like going to the astronomy department and saying, well, I want to learn about stars and sunspot cycles and the rings of Saturn. And they say, oh, you're in the wrong place. We do orbital mechanics. We map the orbits of hypothetical bodies. But if you want to learn about the rings of Saturn, you have to go somewhere else. So but I hope that both in his presentation and in our conversation afterwards, Professor Chang will explain why economics in its familiar form, and there are other schools that he discusses in his very good book, Economics, the User's Guide, why there's so little of the economy in economics. Thanks.
Well, thank you, Mike. Well, you've already done my talk. You know, I mean, that's the summary of it in like 1 minute. But yeah, let me give you a bit more flesh to this. You know, I don't say it explicitly in the book, but I sometimes say that I wrote this book in order to, if you like, democratize economics. Because that economics today is an esoteric subject, which ordinary people cannot understand. So when it comes to economic discussion, people say, oh, yeah, too difficult, you know, too technical. I don't really know, you know, I haven't got a degree. I never taken a course in economics and so on. But why do people take that attitude? Because, you know, when it comes to everything else, people are very happy to pound their opinions despite having no qualification whatsoever. No, I mean, just think about it. I mean, gay marriage, you know, climate change, American foreign policy, you know, you name it. Yeah, I do the same. You know, I have a strong view on American foreign policy, but what do I know about international relations? Yeah? I took one course in international relations back in 1983 when I was an undergraduate student in Korea, and the crusty old professor who taught it used a textbook from the early 60s. Yeah? So what little international relations theory I know is 50 years old. And then I say all kinds of things. I'm sure you are the same, you know. Yeah, so this curious state of affairs has come to be because my professional colleagues have been fantastically successful in convincing the rest of the world that the stuff is so difficult that you don't understand it even if we try to explain it to you. So no need to sweat over it, just go home, you know, be happy, you know. But why? Why should it be like that? And indeed, in my previous book, 23 Things They Don't Tell You About Capitalism, I wrote a brief professional suicide note and said 95% of economics is common sense, which my colleagues hate. Of course, common sense, but made to look difficult, you know, because we use all kinds of jargons and equations and graphs, and to scare people off, yeah, basically. And I believe that even the remaining 5% can be understood in its essence, if not in all technical details, if somebody bothers to explain it in an accessible way, which is what I at least try to do in this book. So I pull all the stops I can think of. You know, I give you Mary Poppins, I give you The Simpsons, yeah? Or at least Ned Flanders, my favorite Simpsons character. You know, I give you My Fair Lady, I give you Gone with the Wind, you name it, yeah? I try. But being accessible doesn't mean that I'm trying to give my readers some baby version of economics or dummy's guide to economics. Yeah? Five things you need to know about inflation, you know, three things that you have to know about the Chinese economy. No, I don't do that. Yeah? I take my readers very seriously and talk about all kinds of serious issues. You know, what is economics? Yeah? Can it be a science? Can economics and politics be separated? Yeah? What are the ethical implications of economic discussions and so on? So in this book, who's got another reincarnation in the form of the Pelican paperback edition, which actually came out a few months earlier in Britain, the book basically tries to offer something completely different, as Monty Python used to say. Huh? It is really different because, as you can see from this table of contents, I talk about a lot of things that you don't normally find in economics books these days, especially in introductory economics books. Yeah? So chapter one has a discussion on what is economics. Chapter two and chapter three are basically history of capitalism. Chapter four, different approaches or different schools of economics. Chapter five discusses economic actors, you know. In the standard economics textbook, they'll say, well, there are the households and companies and governments. But I actually go into greater detail trying to show you that, you know, not all companies are the same, you know, that there are cooperatives, you know. I mean, households are, you know, made up of not just kind of standalone individuals, but individuals who have their roots in society, who sometimes get organized as unions. You know, some of the companies are cooperative rather than corporations, and so on and so on. So, you know, quite different stuff there. And also in terms of the topics, I talk about things like production and work, which are curiously ignored in the economics today. I'll talk about at least some of them later, so let me move on. And then my book introduces, thank you, people to lots of what I call real life numbers. You know, economics is supposed to be a numbers subject. And indeed, if you open an economic book, you will find lots of numbers, except that economists really do not know these numbers. Yeah, so if you have anyone who has graduated with an economics degree, grab him or her and ask, do you know what the national output of the United States of America is? Many of them will not know it. Even fewer of them will know how big the world economy is. Very few of them will know what proportion of that is produced by the US or China, and so on. Yeah? Because these numbers are not taught. Yeah? Of course, at one level, why do you need to know any of these numbers? Yeah? You need to know only one thing, Google. Yeah? But even to know what to look for, you need to know these numbers. Also, unless you have some feel about these numbers, you can come to a very distorted view of the world. Let me give you a beautiful example, which is mentioned in the book, but not in for this purpose. You know, in the days of the so-called Eurozone crisis, the biggest problem economy was Greece, which was subject to this narrative, which mainly came out of Germany, saying that Greece's economic problem is because the Greek people are lazy. You know, they don't work hard, and then they expect to live like Germans. Yeah? So they need to shape up. You know? And then the focus was all about belt tightening and living within the means. And you know? Actually, these people might have thought twice if they looked up the statistics before they formed the view. Because if you go to the OECD website, which provides information on annual average working hours of citizens of different member countries, you will find that the Greeks work 30% longer than the Germans and 40% longer than the Dutch, who are officially the laziest people in the world. Yeah? No, don't get me wrong, I like it, you know. Why should we work all the time? Yeah? The Dutch have the right the approach to life. But, you know, they work at that basically only half the time that the Greeks work. Yeah? So whatever problem Greece might have, it's not a problem of work ethic. Yeah? The Greek people work really hard. They have the longest working hour in Europe. Yeah? Their problem is productivity. So the discussion should have been about investment, yeah? Innovation, the research and development, education, skills, infrastructure, not about, you know, you are lazy, yeah? Please work harder, kind of a moralistic lecture. Yeah? Well, you know, Americans also should know that Mexicans, your kind of favorite whipping boy when it comes to, you know, the preaching people to work harder. Mexicans actually work 25% longer than the Americans. Eh? Actually, they work the longest hours in the OECD, even longer than my fellow South Koreans, who are supposed to be mindless worker ants. Yeah? The Mexicans took us over a few years ago. Yeah. Because we started becoming lazy. Yeah. Anyway, it's just one small example, but you see what I'm getting at. You know, unless you have some feel about these numbers, you can develop very strange notions about the world, and then you become very susceptible to outrageous theories and policies. Yeah? Okay, throughout the book, I keep providing many real-life numbers, but I also warn my readers that these numbers need to be treated with due skepticism. Eh? I mean, people who have studied economics probably know, but you know, even basic numbers like GDP, gross domestic product, I mean, construction is actually a bit complicated, but very roughly is the total output that an economy produces within a given period, you know, it doesn't include unpaid household work and care work, which is mostly done by women. You know? So this leads to a gross undervaluation of women's contribution to the economy. You know, on many estimates, this amount to about 30% of our economy. Yeah? You don't include it. The standard excuse is, oh, you know, it's not transacted in the market, so how do you know the value of mother's cooking for the child and so on? But, you know, you can, to an extent, estimate it by looking at the price of similar services done by hired domestic workers. Eh? I mean, of course, that domestic worker doesn't provide tender, loving care, so that cannot be monetize, but at least you can try to monetize it to an extent. And indeed, the statisticians collecting this data go to a great length in technical word, impute market value to other activities that are not transacted in the market. For example, if you live in your house that you own, you know, there is no market transaction. But that doesn't mean that you are not consuming housing service. Yeah? So these statisticians say, okay, I mean, that, you know, this house is lived by the owner. What would he have had to pay if he didn't own it and went to the market to rent it. Yeah, yeah, you can estimate that. And they add it. Yeah? So why do we not add household work? Yeah? Okay, the point is not whether this is absolutely right or wrong, but that these numbers are constructed on the basis of very particular theories, very particular political and ethical assumptions. Yeah? This is why Johann Wolfgang von Goethe, the German writer and scientist, said everything factual is already a theory. Yeah? Okay, let's talk about some of these issues in some depth. First, let's talk about the definition of economics. You know, if you ask non-economists what is economics, sorry, it shouldn't be there yet. People normally say, oh, it must be the study of the economy. You know, chemistry is the study of chemicals, biology is the study of living things, sociology is the study of society, so economics must be the study of the economy. Unfortunately, they'll be wrong, at least according to some of these books, the most popular economics books of our time. According to them, economics is the science of everything. Hmm? Well, at least one person's a bit modest, Professor Robert Frank of Cornell University doesn't quite say everything, he says almost everything. Yeah, when you hear this, when they hear this, the usual reaction from non-economists is, are these guys megalomaniac? Yeah? They bungled up their own job. Yeah? They couldn't explain the economy as proven by 2008 financial crisis, and then they claim that they can explain everything. Yeah? They must be megalomaniac. Yeah? Well, I think there's a touch of that, but actually it's not because they are megalomaniac that they make this claim. It's because of this very particular way in which the dominant neoclassical school has defined economics, and it goes back to this definition given by Lionel Robbins, who was the professor at the London School of Economics in the early 20th century. And his definition is basically is the science of choice in the presence of scarcity. Once you define the subject like that, it doesn't have to be applied to the economy. So a lot of economists started writing about applying so-called economic logic, that is rational choice behavior, to non-economic things, and the culmination of it is free economics. Yeah? If you look at free economics, there's hardly anything that has anything to do with the economy. Yeah? It's about Japanese sumo wrestlers colluding with each other. It's American school teachers cheating. About their student marks, it's about British people being horrible to each other in quiz shows. Yeah? There's nothing about the economy. Yeah? So in this definition, economics is defined by its analytical methodology, that is rational choice theory, rather than its object of investigation, that is the economy. But when you think about it, this is a very peculiar definition, because all other subjects, astronomy, physics, chemistry, they are defined by the area of investigation, not by research methodology. So think about the biology department. You go to a biology department, there are people studying living organisms using all sorts of research methodologies. So there are people doing DNA analysis, others doing anatomy, people studying, you know, bone structure almost as if they are structural engineers, you know. There are people doing nasty experiments with rats, people, you know, building mathematical models of animal behavior. Yeah? And there are even people who fly to the jungles of Rwanda, sit with mountain gorillas there all day, and record what they do. Yeah, but they are all called biologists. You know, I haven't met the biologists who say, oh, you know, biology can only be done by DNA analysis. That's the fundamental building blocks of life, and any other method is wrong. But this is effectively what economists are doing today. Actually, as Mike mentioned earlier, the perverse thing is that in this vision of what economics should be, this notion that the less relate to the real world it is, the better it is. So if you are the cleverest in an economics department these days, you do not study the real world. You will do mathematical models of the most obscure things, which might be related to reality by, seven removes, but not immediately, like the Turing machine or information cascade and so on. If you are a bit less clever, you do econometrics, which is analysis of economic data through sophisticated statistical means. If you are less clever than that, you do development economics like I do. But if you can't even do that, you become economic historian. And if you are by any chance going around factories, managing, surveying the managers, trying to understand how real life production is organized, you are considered an idiot. No, I'm exaggerating, of course, but there is that strange notion, because for most economists today, what you study is not what you make an economist. It's how you study it. It's a very perverse thing. So my contention is that economics should become like all other subjects. It should be defined in terms of its area of inquiry. Now, most non-economists might say, gosh, that's so obvious. Why is he wasting time on saying these things? But believe me, this is a heresy in economics department. And unless you break that peculiar the view of what economics should be, we will never have what Mike described as real world economics being taught and learned in universities. Now, one important consequence of this perspective, this definition of economics, is to make neoclassical economists believe that there's only one right way of doing economics, or at least one most correct way of doing economics. But in the book, I try to explain that there are actually no less than 9 major schools of economics, several more if you divide them up differently, or if you include some smaller schools, or if you divide the bigger schools into smaller ones. So please don't think that this is some scientific taxonomy. But there are 9 different approaches. And the interesting thing is that there are no less than 3 different ways of defending the free market. Classical, neoclassical, Austrian. Really, if it economics is a science, there can't be 3 correct theories. So they all defend the free market, but they are all doing it very different ways. So classical economists, Adam Smith, David Ricardo, John Stuart Mill, these people theorized the economy in a completely different way from today's neoclassical economists. Because in neoclassical economics, they are only individuals. The classical economists talked about classes, capitalists, workers, landlords. It's a completely different theory. There are more differences, but I cannot go into that. Neoclassical school, of course, you have to remember this, is not the same as free market economics. This is a common misconception. No, it's not. Neoclassical economics contains the theory called theory of market failure, and therefore it can justify quite a wide range of government intervention. This is why you have left-leaning neoclassical economists like Joe Stiglitz and Paul Krugman, while you also have people like Bob Lucas and Robert Barrow, who are very gung-ho free market economists. So not all neoclassical economists are free market economists, but as far as defends the free market, its defense is, and I'm grossly exaggerating, their defense is that people are rational. People know what they are doing. So just leave them alone. The Austrian defense, I mean, represented by the Friedrich von Hayek and, you know, in America sometimes called the libertarian economics, their defense is completely different. Their defense is no one, including the individuals, really know what's going on. So how dare you, the government, think you can tell other people what to do? Because the Austrians very much emphasize that the world is complex, uncertain, and our rationality is very limited. Yeah, actually, personally, I find that defense of free market much more convincing than neoclassical economy, which has to rely on this totally unrealistic assumption that we can calculate anything, predict everything, and so on. That's not the point. I mean, the point is that there are these distinctive ways of theorizing about the economy and kind of defending a particular policy conclusion. We saw that with reference to free market policy, but you can do it with all the others. So my contention is that we need all these diverse approaches to economics together, because the world is really complex and they do not lend, the world doesn't lend itself easily to explanation by any one single theory. And to illustrate this point, I often talk about what I call the Singapore problem, or life is stranger than fiction. You know, Singapore is a highly successful economy. I mean, it's per capita income today is even higher than that of the United States. And it's praised by many people. But when you read about it in the standard sources, I don't know, the Wall Street Journal, the Economist magazine, standard textbooks on international economics or development economics, we'll only hear about this free trade policy and its welcoming attitude towards foreign investors, which it has. But you will never be told that 90% of land in Singapore is owned by the government, 85% of housing supplied by government-owned housing corporation, most of them subsidized, and a staggering 22% is produced by state-owned enterprise, state-owned enterprises, including the famous Singapore Airlines. So I put it to my students. Give me one economic theory, it doesn't matter what it is, neoclassical, Marxist, Keynesian, that can single-handedly explain Singapore. There isn't such a theory. Because it combines features of some extreme free market capitalism and extreme socialism. You know, it's just an extreme example, but there are other examples. You know, Sweden, you know, people think Sweden's some kind of social democratic paradise where everything is equal and no one owns much more than another. But did you know that there's one family in Sweden, the Wallenberg family? It's spelled Wallenberg, but apparently you have to read it as Wallenberg. This family owns directly and through a foundation controlling stakes, namely shares more than 20-30%, which basically allows the dominant shareholder to control the destiny of the enterprise. This family owns controlling stake in companies whose collective market capitalization is, depending on the year, between 1/3 and 1/2 of Stockholm Exchange. Yeah, I mean, do you have any family like that in America? And I can keep giving you this kind of example, but basically the reality is far too more complex to be explained by just one theory. So in this book, I argue that we should let 100 flowers bloom, let different theories coexist and prosper. Well, this is an expression that, Chairman Mao Zedong once used to encourage debate in China. Of course, he had an ulterior motive. He wanted all the flowers to bloom so that he can cut the ones that he didn't like. And I don't have that intention. I don't have the power. It's a genuine plea for economic pluralism. I actually go one step further. I say that these different theories should be cross-fertilized. I mean, I cannot go into the details, but there are actually surprisingly large scopes for cross-fertilization between different schools, which sometimes regard each other as mortal enemies. So my advice is that you should try not to be a man or a woman with a hammer. Well, the saying that he who has a hammer sees everything as a nail, often attributed to Mark Twain, but I think it's not certain. I mean, it's the kind of thing that he might have said, but you know. Anyway, so the saying, like in the saying, when people acquire one theoretical tool, they begin to apply it everywhere. Sometimes it's applied to the right context for the right purpose, but in other times it's not. So if you have a hammer and start banging everything, it'd be great if you are banging a nail. It might just about work if you are banging a screw, but it'd be totally ineffectual if you are banging a jelly, and it'd be a disaster if you bang an egg. So we need, as I say here, a Swiss army knife with a range of tools. Of course, you need the senses to judge what tool to apply when, and these senses have to be acquired through the study of not just economics, but also politics, history, institutions, ethics, and so on. Okay, let me cut out a bit for the sake of time. Yeah, and then in terms of the subject matters, I mentioned that I talk about a lot of things that other books do not talk about, like production and work. Let me just talk about work. You know, work is a very interesting subject in economics because it's mainly mentioned only when it is absent, unemployment. Yeah. And we don't really think about the work itself. But when you think about it, most of us spend at least half of our waking hours in work. Well, unless you are Dutch, because they don't work, you know. And we definitely spend the majority of work waking hours if we count in the commuting hours, which can be up to 6 hours if you are some unlucky black guy stuck in one of these far-flung townships that the apartheid regime built and didn't provide any public transportation for. You know, these people have to rely on this the things called taxis, which are really minibuses run by these criminal gangsters, totally unreliable service, overcharging, roads are bad. You know, many of these people spend 3 hours just getting into work, 3 hours to get out. They hardly have the time to sleep, you know. It's not just the simple hours that we are spending, you know. A lot of workers are in developing countries are engaged in dangerous work. You know, the death rate from workplace accident in India is something like 50 times higher than in the United States. You know, these people are literally risking their lives to go to work. You know, that we can find the work really boring, like Charlie Chaplin did in modern times. Yeah? We can find it interesting and become more fulfilled. You know, it may even form our identity. I mean, I go into the details in the book, but basically the point is that the work affects us in so many ways, and very often, very fundamentally, down to the level of our identity. But in today's economics, it's more or less ignored, Because the dominant neoclassical theory conceptualizes people basically as consumers. Yeah? So our aim in life is to consume goods and services. Yeah? And work is the inconvenience, or disutility as it is called in the theory, that people have to put up with so that they can earn some income with which they can buy those goods and services. So basically our work is not a matter of concern for this the economist. Yeah, so you know, in a lot of countries, I mean, the US is a good example. In the last couple of decades, you know, the work has become more stressful because work and intensity has been cranked up. There's more psychological pressure. Jobs are more insecure and so on. So a lot of people feel less happy. But then economists come along and say, oh, no, you guys should be really feeling happy because compared to 20 years ago, your income's at 20% higher. Yeah? Why aren't you happy? Yeah? And then we say, I don't know. But we should know, because we are not happy in our work. Anyway, throughout the book, I emphasize that economics is a political subject. Of course, this is another heresy. You know, economists say, oh, economics is a science. You know, New York Times frequently publishes articles written by professors from Harvard and so on, trying to tell you why economics is a science. You know. And they say, oh, you know, economics does its best not to make a political judgment. Yeah, and this has been a century-long project for neoclassical economics, because economics in the beginning was called political economy. Adam Smith wrote about political economy, not economics. And in the late 19th, early 20th century, when the neoclassical school came into being, they said, no, politics is not subject to scientific analysis. We have to get rid of this. So they changed the name, first of all, from political economy to economics. And they introduced this allegedly apolitical criteria to judge what is a better economic outcome. And the most important of it, those is the so-called Pareto criterion. It's named after Vilfredo Pareto, who was a half Italian, half French economist who lived in, taught in Switzerland. And Pareto came up with this principle which says that you cannot call a social change an improvement unless it hurts no one while making at least some people better off. And this is a very serious principle, because he was trying to defend individuals against the tyranny of the majority. And you need to explain this. I give you the one finger story, which isn't in the book, so you at least get something for coming to these talks. Yeah, so the story that I made up is that, you know, someone knocks on my door tomorrow morning and says, oh, Dr. Chang, we found this wonderful technology that will solve climate change problem overnight. I say, wow, that's great. Yeah? And they say, the machine's been built, it's primed up, it's ready to go, but we need one tiny input, which we need to start that machine. And we want you to have the honor of providing that input. And I say, what is it? Yeah? And they say, we need one live human finger. You know, I'll run into my kitchen before they finish the sentence and chop my little finger off and give it to them. Yeah? You know, I'm saving the world. Yeah? But what if it's one arm? I think I should do it. Yeah? But what if it's my life of my whole family? Life of all 49 million South Koreans. Yeah? You know, where do you stop? Yeah? So I think this is a very important principle. Yeah? However, the flip side of this is that, once again, extreme examples helps. If you suppose one country where one guy has a lot of money and everyone else is starving, and you ask this guy, will you pay some taxes equivalent to, 5% of your income so that everyone else can actually, you know, don't have to suffer from malnutrition. If the guy says no, then that's it. Yeah? According to Pareto criterion, you cannot push this guy further, because it hurts one person. Yeah? I'm not saying that the answer to this dilemma is easy. Yeah? You know, if you push it to the extreme, but both become really barbarous principles. Yeah? But the point that I'm trying to make is that whether you like it or not, Pareto criterion, Pareto principle is a political doctrine. Yeah? It's not neutral, it's not apolitical. Yeah? It makes a particular stand. You know, it basically accepts the status quo as given, and then within that, you try to find a way to improve things without hurting anyone, which in practice is often impossible. Yeah? I actually argue that the political nature of economics goes even deeper. So in my previous book, 23 Things They Don't Tell You About Capitalism, I made this point at some length in the first chapter called There's No Such Thing as a Free Market. And to discuss that, I discussed the example of child labor. You know, in the 19th century, when some social reformers were agitating for regulation of child labor, most free market economists were up in arms. Huh? This is going to undermine the very foundation of a free economy, namely the freedom of contract. Huh? These children want to work. These people want to employ them. What is your problem? It's not like these factory owners kidnapped these children and use them as slave labor. It's a voluntary contract. You know? And who are you, the government, to say they shouldn't do it? You know? So at the time, a lot of respectable people were totally in favor of child labor, you know? Because it was consistent with this view that, you know, freedom of contract is the most important thing. You know? Fast forward 200 years later, I really haven't met anyone who says we need to bring back child labor to the United States to make it a truly free market economy. Well, one person almost said it, didn't he? Some of you are laughing, probably you know Newt Gingrich, who in 2012 presidential election campaign said poor children should work as janitors in their schools. Well, apart from him, I don't know anyone who makes this kind of point today. And this change has happened not because economic theory has changed, but our political and ethical standards have changed. Right? As simple as that. Right? So when the very boundary of the market, when the very boundary of the economy is drawn through politics, how can you say that economists cannot or should not at least be entangled with politics? Right? Okay, let me move to the conclusion. Well, my book is not just an explanation of economic theories and facts. It's also about the role of economics in public life. And in that regard, I have three sets of observations to make. The first one, never trust an economist. And that includes me. Now, this creates the kind of paradox that the ancient Greek philosophers used to love. You know? Because if you don't trust any economist, how can you trust this economist who says don't trust any economist? Eh? Well, I'll let the Greeks worry about it, you know. I mean, they are not my ancestors. The point I'm trying to make is that professional economists do not have a monopoly over the truth. And it is entirely possible for people who are not professional economists to have sound judgments on economic issues. And indeed, sometimes their judgments may be even better because they are more grounded in reality and they may have a less narrow perspective. Now, I'm not saying that they are necessarily better, but they could be. More importantly, I would argue that the willingness on the part of ordinary citizens to challenge professional economists and other experts is really a foundation of democracy. When you think about it, all you have to do is to hire the most competent technocrat, I don't know, the economist with a PhD from MIT, you know, Oxford or wherever. What's the point of having democracy? The whole point of having democracy is that the ordinary people can challenge these people. Yeah, and for that reason, I would even argue that we all have the duty to learn some economics. Of course, I mean, we are busy with other things, so I mean, you cannot learn much, but at least some economics, so that you can have an opinion about these things and sometimes, if necessary, challenge the experts. The next point is, I'm not even going to pretend that I can read Latin, so just look at it. This is apparently written on the walls of the city hall of Gouda, the Dutch city famous for cheese making. And I don't know how they managed to come up with this pearl of wisdom in the middle of all that cheese making, but somehow they managed. And I think it's a great sentence. I'm not saying that we shouldn't have an opinion. No, no, we all should have an opinion. We all should have a position, but in the end, we have to have the humility to accept that all theories are partial, including my favorite one. Yeah, probably you believe in it because you think it's less partial than others, but it's still partial, and the world is complex, and I could be wrong. Or maybe my theory was right when I adopted it, but then things have changed so much that now I have to revise my opinion or whatever. And finally, throughout the book, even while I constantly make reform proposals, I emphasize how difficult it is to change the economic reality. Sometimes the difficulty is due to the active attempts by those who benefit from the current arrangements. Lobbying, bribing, media propaganda, even violence. We all know this. But the status quo gets defended sometimes even without some people being actively evil. You know, I mean, you don't need Dr. Evil sitting in the Starbucks tower for the world to be evil, because the world is built in such a way that the status quo gets naturally defended. One reason is that in the capitalist economies, where markets are not, the markets are not the only economic institutions of capitalism, but the most the prominent institutions, markets are run on the basis of on the principle of $1, one vote. So this drastically reduces the ability of people with less money to turn down undesirable options. So a lot of poor Indian workers voluntarily choose to work in a toxic factory. But what is this choice? You will accept the choice only when you think the underlying socio-economic order is A, just, and B, cannot be changed. So in this context, I'm always reminded of this things that was said by this Brazilian bishop, Helder Camara, who was one of the leaders of the left-wing Catholic theology that was popular in Latin America in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, called liberation theology. And Helder Camara said, when I give food to poor people, people call me a saint. But when I ask why these people do not have enough to eat, they call me a communist. And in that sense, we should all become a bit of a communist. You should, when you see people making choices that you would not make, you have to ask, why are they making those choices? And then you will find out why by looking at the underlying distribution of income, power, and wealth. And then you may still conclude that, yes, this is why they are doing it, but realistically speaking, this is not going to change. We can never change, or if we try to change it, it will make things even worse or whatever. But without that deliberation, you will accept anything that the status quo throws at you. Yeah, of course, I mean, like Ronald Reagan said, that these people choose to sleep on the street. You know, it's a lifestyle choice. You know, if they want to sleep on the street, let them be. You know, and, some people who want to have a pink phones and lime green phones and so on. Another reason why the status quo gets more easily defended is that people are susceptible to beliefs that go against their own interest. This used to be known as, especially among Marxists, that false consciousness. After the 1999 movie, we call it the Matrix. Yeah, I mean, I'll give you a perfect example from this country. You know, in the days following the debate on so-called Obamacare, I saw this incredible footage of some people demonstrating against Obamacare. Well, I mean, there were a lot of those photos, but it's not the demonstration itself that shocked me, in which these two old, presumably a couple, pensioners were demonstrating with this placard that said, "Government hands off my Medicare." Isn't Medicare a government program, you know? These people are so brainwashed by the insurance industry that the government programs never work, that they thought, because Medicare works, this can't be a government program. So the government is talking about some healthcare reform. They must be trying to raid Medicare and destroy it. Let's go out and demonstrate against it. You know, when you have that level of false consciousness, I mean, it becomes very easy to defend the status quo. Anyway, I made you too pessimistic, you know, while acknowledging the difficulties involved in changing the status quo. We should not give up the fight to create a better economy and better society. Yes, changes are difficult, but in the long run, when enough people fight for them, many impossible things happen. You know, 200 years ago, if someone advocated abolishing slavery in this country, the best description that the person would have got is unrealistic. Yes, I mean, it was unrealistic in the sense that at the time, the U.S. economy was totally dependent on export of tobacco and cotton to Europe, which was produced by slave man plantations in the South. You know, 100 years ago, Britain and many other countries put women in jail for asking for vote. And actually, at the time, a lot of women themselves said, "We don't need votes. Why do we need votes when we have our husbands and fathers and brothers who can represent our views?" But today, you know, no serious country says, only men should have vote. You know, 56 years ago, most of the founding fathers of post-World War II nations, including Israel, were hunted down by the British and the French as terrorists. But now we have all these countries that have become independent, and these people are revered as founding fathers. So these things have happened. And these kind of things will keep happening if enough people fight for their causes. And this is why I quote Antonio Gramsci, the Italian Marxist political thinker, that we need to have pessimism of the intellect, but optimism of the will. You have to be realistic about the power of status quo and the scope of changes that you can make in your own time. But in the long run, a lot of changes can be made. And I cannot think of a better quote than the one I'm going to give you from Nelson Mandela to describe that, when he said, "It always seems impossible until it is done." Thank you.
Yeah. Let me begin by recommending the previous book among Dr. Chang's many books. This one he didn't mention, Kicking Away the Ladder, which is an excellent history of how industrial countries like the United States, Germany, and Japan actually developed. It was largely by flouting what modern development economics says you should do. One of the basic themes I drew from your presentation was that instead of being a single methodology with everything as its subject matter, economics should be a defined area of investigation, which is studied through various different methodologies.
Exactly, yeah.
But let me just press you a bit further on that. Even if you define it that way, I think most people would say, well, economics is the study of markets. In modern industrial societies like the United States, which are called capitalist countries, on average between 40 and 50% of GDP is the government sector. In the United States, we pretend that it's a little above 30% of GDP, but that leaves out tax expenditures, tax breaks, you know, which most economists think are subsidies through the tax code. Once you add them in, we're up there with Germany and France. It's above 40%. So just by my own rough calculations, you then add the nonprofit sector, of which things like the New America Foundation are part. It's a few percent of GDP. There's home production, which you you mentioned. So that leaves you, by my guess, I've never seen a calculation of this, the actual private sector, which is not nonprofit and non-government, is a minority of economic activity, even in so-called capitalist countries. You can then divide the private sector at least three ways. You have price-regulated public utilities, like Pepco, which are not free market. They're privately owned, but they're not free market. There are industries with increasing returns to scale, which tend to be monopolies or oligopolies, you know, Google or Boeing or whatever. And they're not truly competitive markets in the way that you're taught in Econ 101. So my guess is, not having done the math.
And you haven't counted the cooperatives.
Cooperatives, that's right. So that adds a couple of percent. So you end up with maybe 15 or 20% of the economy, which is actually a free competitive market with lots of small firms, which are price takers, not price makers, and so on. It so that just, I just wanted you to respond to how weird this is. So instead of having a textbook which spends half of its pages on the public sector and then maybe 15 or 20% on competitive markets, it's all about competitive markets.
That's right. You're absolutely right. You know, I mean, first of all, you have to remember that the economy is not the same as the market. Market is only a small portion of the economy. Herbert Simon, the father of behavioral economics and father of artificial intelligence and father of operational research, I mean, he had so many children. He once estimated that only about 20% of the U.S. economy actually is the organized through the market. A lot of the rest of it is either government or command within corporation. You know, when companies run their affairs, I mean, they buy and sell from each other, but a lot of time, what they do is say the Toyota headquarter in Japan tells its the engine factory in Thailand to sell X number of engine to its car factory in Pakistan, but that's not a market transaction. Toyota decides how many will be sold at what price.
But John Kenneth Galbraith described corporations as islands of socialism in a sea of capital.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. So the way you put it is another way of putting it, government is huge, the many private sector companies are either regulated or monopolies, or cooperatives or non-profits, and then really the kind of market economy populated by little consumers and little companies that you see in economic textbooks is 10, 15, maximum 20% of the economy. So yes, I mean, this is a very important point. I mean, you should remember that. And then I partly talk about it in chapter 5, where I discuss who are the real economic actors. Yeah? You have to realize how the economy is really organized, as opposed to organized in this fairy tale that you see in the standard economic textbook. I mean, let me give you another example. I mean, we also get deceived by names quite easily. So, I mean, the United States has hardly any state-owned enterprise, as we normally classify. But I would say that it has a state-owned enterprise that has been the most successful in human history, that is the military. Yeah, I mean, without the US military, we will not have the information age. The computer, the semiconductor, the internet, they were all developed through military research. And Americans think they don't have a state-owned enterprise and they don't have industrial policy. So the real nature of the economy is vastly different from
this changed in our lifetime. I remember even in the 60s and 70s when I was young, it was commonplace to describe the US and Western Europe as mixed economies.
Absolutely.
It was a blend of capitalism, socialism, utilities.
Yep.
And then after Reagan and Thatcher and then Clinton and Blair, suddenly we became market economists.
That's right, yeah. Mixed economy was not just a description, but a philosophy, which was developed during the days of the New Deal and post-war reconstruction across the world, that neither pure capitalism nor pure socialism is good. You need, different elements deliberately mixed to have a more balanced society. Of course, the exact balance will differ across countries because they have different political values and the moral codes and culture and so on. But everyone agreed that we have to mix these things. And then with the 1980s Reagan Thatcher revolution, we were told that we have to become as pure as possible a market economy.
We'll take some questions. Do we have someone with a microphone back there? If not, just we'll start in the front row. Please speak up. Here comes the microphone.
Hi, Robert Schroeder with International Investor. Thanks for your talk, and look forward to reading the book.
Thank you.
I want to get to this point of, I think one of the benefits of what you're doing and others who ask these questions is by comparing nations around the world, perhaps we should all be picking up better ideas of how to run our own affairs.
Mm-hmm.
Should we be doing more to make those comparisons more vivid in terms of the reality on the ground for most people?
Mm-mm.
And let me get to my specific question. Here we have what seems to... to us, at least, an obsession with GDP growth, constant, and it's not just in the U.S. but World Bank and IMF.
Yeah.
Everybody seems to.
Yeah.
Are there better measures that translate more to what's really best for most people?
Thank you. Yeah. On the first point, yes. I mean that strangely, we have lost this ability to, or even the desire to learn from real life experiences, and we all try to learn from some textbook, which doesn't even half correctly reflect the complexity and nuances of the reality. So, just to give you a random example that I just remembered, in the early 20th century, when the U.S. The small farms in the United States were really getting destroyed and suffering, the government tried to improve farmers' access to credit. And in order to do that, they actually repeatedly sent missions to Germany and Sweden and so on to find out how those countries are actually doing these things. But now, you look up some textbook written by some professor somewhere, and you think that's the reality. So yes, I am a great fan of us learning about the real economy, and you keep finding shocking things. I already gave you Singapore and Sweden, but I can give you many more examples where the conventional economic theories that are turned upside down, and you know, the what you thought was a regularity turns out to be a peculiarity, and so on. So I really encourage you to learn about the real world economies. Now, as for GDP, yes, I mean, probably if someone presses me, I would say that despite all these problems, GDP, that is income, is still the single best measure of our welfare. But then why should we use just one measure? So actually now that a lot of people are advocating using multiple measures. So for example, if you go to the OECD website, they have started an interesting initiative called Better Life Index. It's try to look at 48 different things, you know, work-life balance, income, quality of education, the crime, you know, to judge how different nations are doing. And I think, you know, messy as it is, that's the only way that you can make a balanced judgment, because if you pick just one thing, I mean, it just makes your whole perspective lopsided and lead to wrong policies.
At one point in relation to your first question, there's a very well-developed scholarly literature about comparative capitalism. It's called The Varieties of Capitalism School. And it looks at the Anglo-American model, at the Scandinavian social democracies, at the corporatist Franco-German model.
Right.
It is written by political scientists, not by economists.
That's
right here, third row.
I'm Norman Kurland from the Center for Economic and Social Justice. And my question relates to the system that fails to produce enough so that we have poverty. What the tax system, particularly central banking and the credit system and the inheritance system. But these systems are all created by people and therefore can be recreated by the people. And what I am not hearing is the fact that we need new capital formation. We add roughly $2 to $3 trillion of new capital formation every year in both the public sector and the private sector. And the issue, what seems to me to be missing, is who's going to own it? Why can't it be owned by the people? Mm-hmm. Why can't there be equal opportunity to own? And some of the laws are moving in that direction. And that was for workers in this country, it is possible to become owners of companies without putting up your own money, borrowed money paid for out of future savings.
Yep. Shall I collect a few questions?
Okay.
Yeah, that might be
the gentleman in yellow shirt.
More effective,
My name is John Starzak, and I'm a retired patent examiner, so my formal background is in science and engineering. And I think part of the big part of the problem is there's been a number of economists who are trying to set forth the idea that economics is a science much like physics and chemistry, and what they say is correct. Now, two examples I would give is if it were, say, thermodynamics was like economics, you could pick up 8 different thermodynamic books that would say fundamentally different things. But of course, you pick up any thermodynamics book, and they basically say the exact same thing.
Mm-hmm.
And similarly, you know, there's been much talk about GDP as if it's like a similar to voltage or amperage.
Mm-hmm.
It's farther from the truth. There's nothing,
exactly,
GDP meter.
Yeah.
When I weigh something on a balance, if I say I've got 100 milligrams of something, I've got 100 milligrams.
Exactly, yeah.
In my opinion, GDP, they have the theoretical, but GDP is really just the numbers that they add up.
Yep.
And they could be wrong, they could be
exactly
further from the truth.
Yep.
We'll take one more question.
Yeah, one more,
Right here.
Bob Shadler, American Foreign Policy Council. I would like to ask about something that I think is central to economics, employment and unemployment.
Mm-hmm.
And in doing so, might like to push back and defend South Koreans, contrary to what you suggested.
Mm-hmm.
That is, when you compared South Koreans to the more industrious Mexicans,
mm-hmm.
you seem to conflate hours at a place of work. Mm-hmm. And so in terms of trying to assess employment and unemployment, I would like your views about how economists should go about doing that for four groups of people. The very wealthy, Mitt Romney, Bill Clinton, Bill Gates, intellectuals, academics and non-academics, entrepreneurs who are innovating, and people who work for family firms. Mm-hmm. How do we figure out whether they're employed or unemployed?
Yeah.
And is there any difference between South Korea and England in these four categories? Thank you.
Well, on the first point, yes, no, I completely agree with you that all these economic rules, institutions, laws, I mean, they are human creations and they can be and should be and have been changed. The only thing I want to add is you don't necessarily need ownership to be able to influence, for example, your enterprise. Different countries have found different means. So in Germany, they have a so-called co-determination system where they have two layers of board. One is managerial board, which is same as other countries' board of directors, and the other is supervisory board. And in supervisory board, workers have basically 49% representation. I'm not saying that that's not necessarily the correct model for everyone, but so in that way, they exercise influence on enterprise management. In Japan, they don't even have that kind of formal representation, but they have developed these customs in which at least full-time the workers have some influence in the management of the company. So yes, I mean, there are lots of different ways we can do this. And of course, not to forget about trade unions. So let's explore all these diverse possibilities. Yes, I often joke that numbers in economics are like sausages. You know, you don't know what's going into them. You don't want to know what's going into them. So, these number. If you ask physicists, probably they'll say even they are not 100% objective. But in physics, you can calculate things down to 17th decimal point. You know, in economics, you just can't do that because that the data itself are generated in a very dubious way. Now, employment and unemployment, well, I keep, sorry, that I would just mention that, yes, I mean, that measuring productivity is actually a very difficult thing, especially when so much of our economic activities are done in a collective way. Now, if one person is, making a chair, it's pretty easy to see how productive or unproductive that person is. But we are living in a world where a lot of production is done in a very complex factory with minute division of labor. So how do you really know that this guy who, designed the door handle for General Motors made exact contribution equivalent to the salary he got paid? You cannot know. So a lot of economic productivity and therefore compensation are kind of results of social arrangements rather than pure physical productivity. So all those categories that you pointed out, that these are especially difficult categories because entrepreneurs, how can we exactly calculate the contribution of Steve Jobs? It's impossible. So let me just leave it at that. Yeah.
Well, on that point, the classical economists tended to be quite hostile to capitalists who were passive investors. Mm. John Stuart Mill described such people as people who make money while they sleep.
Yeah.
That was not intended as a compliment.
No.
And Keynes spoke about the euthanasia of the rentier, which wasn't very friendly either,
That's right,
if you
yeah.
think about it. Let's get some from the back. Bruce, next, to, no, first, yeah, both of you.
Right.
Bruce, do you have a question?
Well, we've got 10 gazillion studies correlating GDP with all kinds of things, such as interest rates and the money supply and various other things that we know are more or less true. Yeah. So whatever GDP measures is a useful measure for a lot of things. And I think, you know, coming up with all these critiques that have been around, you know, ever since the idea came up, I mean, I was just mentioning to Pete, Oscar Morgenstern's great book on the accuracy of economic observations, you know, made many of these points ages ago, so it's not new stuff. And I just feel like it's a little bit like beating up somebody who's, you know, not there to defend themselves.
Well, yeah.
Why don't we answer those two?
Oh, okay, yeah. Piketty, I haven't read him, so I'm not willing to comment on him, but, you know, I mean, I think from the things I've read about him, I think this is a position that he would probably accept himself. You know, people don't often realize that inequality can be changed hugely through public intervention. So if you go to the OECD website, you'll find two sets of income inequality data, Gini coefficient data. One is before tax and transfer, and the other is after. And from there, you will find that many European countries, Sweden, Germany, Belgium, not every year, but in many years, will have higher income inequality than the United States before tax and transfer. So these people do a lot of things to change that. And of course, I mean, even in those countries, that those redistributive policies have become a bit weaker, and so on, but you know, it's not a foregone conclusion that you have to accept whatever market throws at you in terms of income inequality, because there are a lot of things you can do to change that. Yeah. As for my comment on GDP, yeah, of course it's not new. You know, I didn't claim that it is new, but you know, sometimes people don't know these things, and please don't forget that this was written for people who have very little knowledge of economics, but. You know, I kept saying that I said earlier that GDP is probably the single best measure still. So I'm not rejecting its use. Please read the book if you're interested in finding out exactly what I think about it.
We've got time for one more round of a few questions. Right here.
Yes, Stephen Schafferman with the Basic Income Guarantee Network. And I'd just like to hear your comments about the idea of basic income, which is getting a lot of attention now in England and Switzerland and even in the U.S. mainstream media, updating the negative income tax guaranteed income debates from the 60s.
And one more, right here.
In general, do you think that the bailout of the banks in 2008-09 was actually worth the effort or not?
Yeah, one wonders, yeah. Is that okay?
You want one more?
I don't know. Okay. Yeah, if there's
right
one more, yeah.
Jim Case from Baltimore. I noticed on your list of economics, of different styles of economics, there was no mention of energy economics or biophysical economics or some of the other names that has, the thrust of which is we're running out of fossil fuels and we're going to be a whole lot poorer when we do.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah. On basic income, well, my view is that, you know, actually all countries with some degree of welfare state and some degree of labor regulation actually have an implicit basic income. Yeah? I mean, only that you are not allowed to take it in cash. Yeah? So you could say that an average British person gets X amount of health benefit through the nationalized national health system, X amount of educational benefit through the nationalized school system, and so on. And you could turn it into cash and give it to people and make it the basic income. That's one the approach. But you know, some people who might agree the notion of basic income might say that, however, there are certain things that we all agree that should be consumed by everyone to an extent. Then you know, there's always a danger that if you keep the people things in cash, that they might be spending it in the wrong things. Yeah. So, no, I'm not taking any side in this. But I think that we need to carefully think about it. I think that this idea that we need to give people things only in kind is too paternalistic. On the other hand, giving it all in cash, you know, when you give to vulnerable people, they might get exposed to, you know, loan sharks and fraudsters. And so, I don't know. I mean, I want to think about it a bit more carefully. Bank bailout, yes, I do wonder whether we should have done that. I think given the circumstances, I think that was inevitable. But then I think what we should have done is to put a lot of conditions on these banks. No, it's quite amazing. When you are giving tiny bit of money to the poor people for welfare, you put all kinds of conditions. But when you are giving billions to a bank, there is no condition. Yeah, this is why Gore Vidal once famously said that the American economic system is socialism for the rich and capitalism for the poor. So I think that's what went wrong, because at the time, if you didn't bail out these banks, probably the whole system would have collapsed. Yeah? But then, you know, I mean, the American government, the British government, they went out on a limb to kind of deny public any say in this. So for example, American government, when it bailed out General Motors, it took preferred stock, meaning that you get a higher dividend, but you have no voting right. Yeah? I think this was a serious dereliction of duty on the part of Obama administration. Yeah? They gave billions of your money to this company and voluntarily chose not to exercise any control. Yeah? You've been swindled. Yeah? British government, when it poured in billions of pounds into banks, decided that these banks will be controlled by this the semi-public company managed arm's length from the government, thereby deliberately diluting its ability to control its affairs. That's the same example. Well, the reason why I didn't mention ecological economics and biophysical economics and those things, I mean, I was just trying to explain the main ones. I mean, the main ones do not necessarily mean they are more important or better, but you know, from a professional economist point of view, you know, there are these things that have appeared more frequently in economics than others, and I didn't get to include those because they were less prominent. So, I mean, I'm happy to criticized for that, but I do have a little bit of discussion on the issues of climate change and environment in the chapter I discuss production, because a lot of people think that we are basically running on a planet, and how can we then reconcile with economic growth? And I have some things to say about that there. So if you're interested, you can look at that.
The book is Economics: The User's Guide by Ha-Joon Chang. You can buy copies outside. After you join me in thanking Dr. Chang.